Hey guys, Yulia here. So today I wanted to show you some native plants that are blooming in the garden right now. And I wanted to start with this beautiful native shrub that I'm standing right next to. This is Clethra alnifolia. And as you can see, it is covered with these gorgeous bottle brush-like flowers. And in the wild, it actually grows on the banks of rivers and lakes. So it prefers wetter soils. But in my own garden, I actually didn't find it too fussy as for the soil or watering requirements. So I think it will grow pretty much anywhere. So as you can see, this shrub is about 6 feet tall, and this particular specimen is about 7 years old, and I bought it at about 2 feet tall. So they can get pretty big, but you can size control them. If they're a little bit too big for you, I like my plants big in the garden, so I don't prune these. So again, about the flowers, gorgeous flowers, extremely fragrant, and they have this specific, to me, almost summer-like fragrance, very sweet. In fact, if I go to someone else's garden or public park, I know there's clethra blooming somewhere because this is just intoxicating scent. It also has gorgeous fall color. In fact, if I'll find the footage, we did a fall garden tour last fall, and I think this plant was in that tour with all this beautiful fall color. Now, one thing about clethra is that it is very slow to start in the spring, and everything else would be leafed out, and clethra will still look like a bunch of sticks, and you think it's dead, but it actually is not. So the test is you can just sort of rub the bark, and if you can see green in it, it's definitely still alive. Do not cut it down, do not remove it. It will wake up in time. It is absolutely gorgeous, covered with pollinators all day long. As you can see, there's still bees on it. It's end of the day, it's still covered in bees. There are butterflies that are visiting it all the time. As for the flower color, they come in white and ranges of pink. So this particular variety is actually Ruby Spice. So there are straight species and there are some cultivars of Clethra alnifolia. So there are a lot of choices as for the colors and sizes. This is Liatris. This is a beautiful perennial, and you can buy these plants as bulbs or as plants in pots. I actually prefer to buy these as bulbs because the bulbs are really inexpensive and you can cover a lot of ground this way. The bulbs are teeny tiny, and I usually start them early in the spring, and you will see blooms the next year. The interesting thing about these plants is that when the flowers open, they actually start from the top and they continue to the bottom. Usually on these sort of like a candle-like structure flowers, flowers start from the bottom and they go up to the top. Here's another gorgeous native perennial. This is Agastache. And Agastache is actually in the mint family. And the way you can tell mint family is by their square stems. Now this particular variety is called Purple Haze, and I absolutely love it. It blooms forever. This particular plant has probably been blooming for like a month and a half. I did not shear it. It sort of creates this new stalks of flowers all the time. They are favored by pollinators. The foliage has this very interesting fragrance. It's sort of minty, but different. I love it. I absolutely love it. Now, this plant does have a special requirements. It's definitely a full sun plant. You cannot grow this in part shade. It will just flop all over the place. It is also very drought tolerant, so don't give it too much water. Otherwise, it may rot. But other than that, it's not fussy at all. And as you can see, I grow it in my devil strip, which is kind of tough conditions, dry soil, you know, full sun. So this is definitely perfect spot for it. Here's another beautiful native perennial, Eupatorium maculatum. And as I mentioned before, I like my plants big. I like to get lost in the garden. I like to get lost in nature. And I would say this plant is about 7 feet tall. Now, if you are not ready to grow something this big in your garden, or if your garden is a little too small, you can try growing a different variety of Eupatorium. Baby Joe, for example, has the same beautiful flowers, but it's only 4 feet tall. So Eupatorium, almost all of them, there are a number of different species, have these beautiful flowers that are covered with pollinators. In fact, I even have seen a couple of monarchs on it a couple of days ago. And also gorgeous leathery leaves. Now in the wild, they prefer wetter soils, but in my own garden, they pretty much grow anywhere and not too fussy about the soil or watering requirements. So they are late to start in the spring, so make sure you don't dig around too much in the area where they're planted, because the rhizomes are still there. You don't want to damage them. I do get asked about the aggressiveness of this plant. So in my experience, this is not aggressive at all. This clump is about 8 years old. I only divided it twice and gave it away to my friends, and it sort of stays compact. In fact, it was growing very, very slow up until year five, and then it started spreading around a little bit more. It doesn't seed around a lot. I've only seen a couple of seedlings over the last 8 years. Let me show you some native grasses real quick. Now, the grasses probably require their own video, but since this switchgrass or panicum totem pole is uplit with the sun right now, it looks absolutely gorgeous. I can't pass this by. So this is Panicum virgatum totem pole, and panicums do have a number of different varieties. This one I planted last year, and I'm in love with this because it's tall, it's beautiful, it's very sturdy. A lot of switchgrasses of the older cultivars tend to flop. This one has performed absolutely beautifully in the devil strip that I have here, despite all the snow we had, despite all the salt that's been thrown on it in the winter. It is blooming, it is gorgeous. It has these very blue foliage. I don't know if you can see that in the light. And the thing about grasses is that it's one of the few plants that just moves so beautifully in the wind. So let me show you some others that I have here. Here's a Panicum virgatum Shenandoah, and as you can see, it has these beautiful red markings on the leaves, and the seed heads look sort of like millet. And the video does not do it any justice, because the way it is so beautifully translucent and the way it moves in the wind. The one thing about switchgrass is that they have extensive root system. Actually, that could be said for all of the native grasses and a lot of native perennials. So they can hold erosion and hold the soil really well, but that also makes them very hard to divide. So when you have to divide your grasses, which I don't do often, they are not as aggressive as Miscanthus can be, you have to bring your saw, because that's the only way I can cut them and divide them. And here's another native grass. This is little bluestem or schizocarium, and I absolutely love it. However, I do not have enough sun for it. This particular grass requires all the sun that you can give it, and it does prefer drier locations, otherwise it will flop. In fact, you probably can't tell, but the one on the right, I had to stake. I mean, I still grow it because I enjoy it so much, but I have to put a little bit more attention toward it. There are different varieties of little blue stems as well, so definitely check this one out. And here is a plant that you're probably familiar with. This is Phlox paniculata. And yes, garden phlox is indeed native to the eastern United States. I'm sure you all have seen this plant, and there are hundreds of cultivars of Phlox paniculata. Beautiful flowers, very fragrant, attract lots of pollinators, and also blooms for a very long time in the garden. Now, one thing that I do with my phlox is I Chelsea chop it. And what Chelsea chop is basically cutting a third of your plant before June 1st in my area. So I cut it right here. And as you can see, it forms two stalks. So this way you actually have more flowers, and they're also not as floppy, because if I would let this plant grow, it probably would be about 5.5 feet tall. But this way it's nice and compact. Now, since I'm standing here, there's another gorgeous native that a lot of people are familiar with. This is Echinacea purpurea. Echinacea purpurea is also has a lot of different cultivars. And in my experience, cultivars do not perform as well as the straight species. And a lot of times they die off and they seed and they pretty much become and revert to the straight species. There is another Echinacea that I will mention quickly, Echinacea pallida, that I grew this year. I actually started it from seed last year and it bloomed. It's one of my best plants. However, it's not as long blooming as the Echinacea purpurea. Okay, I know this plant is not blooming, but I think it still looks very decorative. This is Baptisia australis. And the foliage is absolutely beautiful. It has this blue tinge to it. And check out the seed pods. I think they're extremely decorative. They're almost black in color. So Baptisia is one of those perennials that is very slow to start. So if you plant it from a pot, it will take you a couple of years before you see it fill in nicely. And it's so worth waiting for, though. The flowers are beautiful, the foliage is very decorative, and the seed pods. And I think it's just a very interesting plant. All right, you guys, I hope you're inspired to plant some native plants in your own garden. And I wanted to include a little bit more information as to why you should be planting native plants, but I thought that topic deserves its own video. Let me know if I should make a video about that. But also, I will post all of the sources as to where I buy my native plants in the description down below. Anyway, thank you so much, you guys, for watching. I hope you learned something new in this video, and I will see you in the next one.